Bismillah, walhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. My dear sisters and my brothers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Mind control and brain washing. These two techniques have been used by man against man for so long, especially in matters of war, espionage, and religion. It's been used by the church, it's been used by the synagogue, and it has been used also by the mosque or by the masjid, i.e. our Muslim scholars. I am not going to speak about what the church did, or what Christianity did, or Judaism did, or what World War I did, or what World War II did, or Japan, or other kind of stuff. But I want to speak specifically about our brothers, i.e. the Muslim scholars or preachers that you listen to today on the internet. That is because brainwashing and mind controlling are very sneaky and vile techniques to keep people under far away from the freedom that Allah has given to mankind. One of the great gifts that Allah has given us that He has not given to the angels and has not given to the devils, at least Iblis. And that is the freedom to choose, the freedom to do what we want. We have got that ability. The angels do not have it. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala holds us accountable on Judgment Day. And also based on that, He will either reward us with paradise or reward us with hell fire. The angels will not have that privilege on Judgment Day. The problem with these techniques or the mind control and brainwashing is that the shuyukh themselves, they don't do it in the sense that they want to harm people. But they do it in a way that is harmful to people, as you will see, and you will see the techniques. That is because the sheikh will just give the talk and he thinks like what he's preaching is the absolute truth, and as such he will deliver to you what he thinks and behaves and believes and everything in that package of this is the absolute truth. Anything else than that is harm coming to your way. And since we are all Muslims, I will speak to you in all freedom, because what you need to know is the ability that Allah has given you, the freedom to choose the religion that you want. Let me explain. On Judgment Day, when you stand in front of Allah to be held accountable for your deeds, the book that is going to act as the bridge between you and the paradise or hellfire is the Qur'an. You will not be able on Judgment Day to mention the hadith, for example. You will not be able on Judgment Day to say, my scholar did this and say that. Because Islam came to you and you study, you do what you need to do to come up with a belief. And based on that belief that you ended up with, Allah will ask you on Judgment Day. This is why this Islam is not a mass religion, i.e. it's one set of beliefs, one set of behavior, and then an entire population behaves accordingly. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he was in Al-Madinah, or throughout his 23 years, did not ask the companions to dress in one particular way. He gave them rules as to what would make someone act as an arrogant, someone who is high above everyone, show off. And he told them, don't do that. So he gave them the theory to apply. And then they applied it to all that kind of dresses that they dressed. Today, we live in the West, in London or New York, wherever you are, and or at the university, wherever, and you find someone completely dressed as a Bedouin of the desert. The problem with dress is not the dress itself. You can dress as you like. To me, as much as you like, you can come in a whole kameez, or you can go to Michael Schumacher and buy his racing suit, and you come with it and you study with it, or you go work with it. To me, is you dressed. But once you turn a particular dress and you make it like this is what Islam commands and says, then that is a problem. And also because the mind control and the brainwashing techniques are used by a great number of preachers. Many of these preachers will refuse to sit down and debate their own thoughts because actually they can't sustain these ideologies that they preach once faced with other ideologies. And for that, they always will run away from debate, but they will always attack from far, that you are and you are, as we shall mention, inshallah. So without any further ado, let me tell you about 10 subtle techniques used by these people, either willingly or unwillingly. But most of the time, they use them with a purpose, and that is what makes things extremely difficult for us. The very first technique is Islam says. If you go, say, on YouTube today and you type any topic out there, the speaker will speak in such a manner and he will say, Allah says, the messenger says, Islam says. So they boxed so many issues and they made them that this is what Allah wants. They speak as if they were another messenger that Allah sent to humanity, except we didn't receive any from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala signs that this person here is a messenger. You tell them about, for example, when it comes to the dress of women, they speak as if Allah has revealed upon them a Qur'an that tells them that the women should dress like this or men should dress like that, or that gold is haram or that thing there, and they will preach to you as if they had the absolute truth, when in fact there is hardly any issue on Islam except those issues that Allah has spoken directly, openly, clearly about them in the Quran that cannot bear more than a meaning. For example, Allah is one. Scholars will never ever disagree on this issue, that they believe in the angels and all these things. But for example, when it comes to the angels, Allah has said that He creates angels with 2 wings, 3 wings, 4 wings, more than that, less than that. Scholars again do not debate this issue because none of them has seen the angels. But when it comes to rules to regulate a community, a Muslim community, this is where the scholars go all the way about it, and this is where Islam says. Predominantly, this issue here of Islam says came with these, especially Salafi people, throughout history because the ruler always, always supported the sheikh, because the shuyukh always work for the government, just like it is today in Saudi Arabia or in Egypt or anywhere else. As long as the sheikh is supporting directly or indirectly the government, he is in good terms. Like, for example, the case of a Sudais today, who is a pro-government 100%, even if he sells all his brother, the other scholars, like, not like him, but scholars that are there, he doesn't care. So, by him, when he gives a khutbah, it is always Islam says, Allah says. Now, this would not have been a huge problem, but the problem is they are changing the religion of Allah. If this was about cars or trains or anything, guess what? No big deal. But this is about the religion of Allah. This big lie of the epidemic where they give it the impression to you that this is what Allah says, and because you trust in them greatly, you would really take everything they say at face value and you start believing that what comes out from their mouth is what Allah means. This big problem is also transmitted today through translations. And the most dangerous of them all is the translations of the meaning of the Quran, like Sahih International. That is a 100% Wahhabi translation. In that, it is, you don't find from the English version of it, you will not find what Allah wants. But you will find what the Wahhabi school of thought, what the Hanbali school of thought, what the Salafi school of thought wants you to have. And they will sneak in their point of view there in translation, so much so that you who live in the West that rely on the English version or any other version in any other language that has been supported, financed, and supervised by the Saudi government. It is a 100% Wahhabi dictate. So when you read that, whatever is in that there, when I'm doing my talks, I never ever look at one translation. I always first work out the translation of what Allah says without any agenda. I always treat that as if I was a prophet. And what Allah wants is not what the society wants, what the government wants, what this wants, what Allah wants. Then I look the other translations, 99% I find the Sahih International, totally is just the Hanbali school of thought or the Wahhabi school of thought or what's called today, very wrongly, the Salafi school of thought, packaged as Allah says. So I want you to be now extremely careful when you read your Qur'an or the meanings of the Qur'an in your native language, to make sure you read other translations, especially the English one. Go to Qur'an.com. There are so many other, I think about 10 or 11 different translations. Should you want to read something or should you want to study something, go there and type the ayah in English and the Arabic, and then choose all translations and read. The last one you should read is the Sahih International, because that is the most used and the most manipulated translation you will find. Point number two, they will tell you it is the Sunnah. Anything that they want you to do is the Sunnah. Not much has changed since the 3rd century. In the 3rd century, there has been a great battle between people, Ahlul Ra'i, i.e. people, the philosophers, people who use the brain to think and things like that, and Ahlul Hadith, the people of Al-Hadith. And as I said before in many of my talks, as Ibn al-Jawzi mentioned in the book of Al-Mawdu'at, the fabricated hadith, where many scholars say that whenever they like something, they turn it into a hadith. That rule is a golden rule that you can keep between your eyes every time you hear a Wahhabi Salafi scholar speak or sheikh speak. They will always make sure. Sometimes they can't turn a regular speech into a hadith, but they will turn that speech in such a way that they make you believe that what they are saying is the authentic Sunnah, and that's that. For example, we all know that before you enter toilet, you make a dua. Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min al-khubthi wal-khaba'ith. Every Muslim sees it there. I've seen stickers, I've seen it on doors, I've seen it everywhere you go there. You teach it to your children and so on and so forth. And then on the way out from your toilet, you go ghufranik, you're seeking forgiveness. And then they give you the why that ghufranik, why that forgiveness is there. They say, because every time you make mentioning the name of Allah, and you are always in constant remembering the name of Allah, mentioning the name of Allah, you are always in total obedience. But when you go to the toilet, you just shut up. You don't say a word. And then when you come out, then they tell you, because the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he couldn't mention the name of Allah or do any dhikr or anything in the toilet. So when he comes out, he apologized to Allah too. Oh, yeah, Allah, I'm sorry I didn't have the opportunity. And as such, I say, astaghfirullah. But this is what they say. However, this hadith is not an authentic hadith. It's a good hadith with a great, huge number of scholars that say that this hadith is a weak hadith. Huh, really? I thought like the whole world would crumble down and the mountains will just explode, volcanoes. It's just like the end of the world. When I don't say this hadith, it's the end of the Sunnah. That's it. When in fact, it's a weak hadith. Now add to this, at the time of Rasulullah, they did not have toilets. They would go outside. So how did they hear Rasulullah say the dua and walk into what? And they will tell you there is a hadith in Abu Dawood, and that hadith, but that hadith is weak. Authenticated by Al-Albani. Al-Albani is just one side of the coin. He is not the ultimate prophet that Allah has sent us to authenticate the hadith of Rasulullah. Tons of hadith that Al-Albani alayhi rahmatullah has authenticated, and before his death, he went back on them and weakened them. And some of the hadith, he has classified them as weak and daif and fabricated. Before his death, he changed his mind and he said, no, they are authentic. And many hadith, in one point he says something, in the other end he says something else. And sometimes the hadith has got the same chain of narrators, but in one end he says it's weak and on the other end he says it's authentic. He's a human being, not a computer. So the element, and I can give you like tons of examples about how this, it's a sunnah, but it's actually, it's not. What does the word sunnah mean in Islam? When Allah speaks about the sunnah, sunnat Allah allati, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives something. The sunnah is almost a practical act that you do. For example, yeah, if you always wake up from the bed, you wear your slippers, and then you go and you have your breakfast, and then you put on it. So when you do that continuously, that becomes your sunnah. That's an act you do. So when we say it's a sunnah, so we gotta make sure that it's 100% that Rasulullah ﷺ did that every single day to be acted on as a sunnah. But obviously, a lot of things are not sunnah. And the moment Allah, if someone of these Salafi or those Wahhabi listen to my talk, the first thing they're gonna say is that I am a man who wants to bring down the sunnah of Rasulullah, fight Islam and this and this. But actually, that's not the truth at all. It's a sunnah whenever you hear someone emphasizing something to make you do something and tell you this is the sunnah, you gotta do it because of the sunnah, that is a mind control and a brainwashing technique. That leads me to speak about the third technique that they use, is hiding the opinion of others, scholars, and make the other views as nothing, as worthless points of use. And this also serves another point, is to keep you away from the other scholars. For example, in Saudi Arabia, and the reason why I speak about Saudi Arabia, the Salafi and the Wahhabi think, is because of the wealth and because of the way politics run in Saudi Arabia, when the King Faisal and then after him Fahd and then after him Abdullah and all these people, when they gave the authority. And I encourage you to go and listen to the 19 things that were haram before and they became halal. I speak about the incidents about how the king gave an utmost unlimited authority to the scholars and the reason why, so that they help him, i.e. the scholars help the king maintain the throne. And the reason why is because Juhayman invaded Kaaba. It's all on the other talk. Please do listen to it. So, for example, in this Wahhabi Salafi thing, and because I've lived in Egypt, what happens is this. In Saudi Arabia, they consider the Ash'ari or the Ash'ari school of thought as deviated and headed to hellfire. Not only have I heard it from one scholar, but it's out there. Go on YouTube, type the Ash'ari, and you will believe that these people are disbelievers. They're headed for eternity forever. Even Ibn Taymiyyah, Allah forgive him, said that the Ash'ari are the transsexual. Wallahi al-Azim, sometimes these people, I don't know, Ash'ari mukhannithi. Mu'tazil and Shia, that the Ash'ari are the transsexual, the transvestite of another group. You wouldn't say that, but it's in his books. In Saudi Arabia, they do not acknowledge Al-Azhar as a religious institution. That's why you never ever hear a Saudi tell you something that a scholar from Egypt says. And in retaliation, you don't hear the Azhar or an Egypt scholar speak anything about what comes from Saudi Arabia, except when the Salafism started invading Egypt and three figures were there. I don't want to mention their names, the Shuyukh, and they were pushing for Salafism. Well, in fact, they were actually making money and getting richer and things like that. The videos are on YouTube. So when you are a Salafi, you would hate something called the Muslim Brotherhood. You will hate something called Ash'ari. You will hate Sufism. You will hate. Why? Because Salafis and Wahhabis are extremely professional in hiding the truths that are kept within the books of our history. This is the third technique. Always keep your mind open. Look for the truth. Allah did not send a universal religion only for those Bedouins of Saudi Arabia to control it and use it to their advantage like they did for the last 300 years. People have been murdered and so on. Brings me to point number four, and that is overpraising the scholars. They, especially, I'm talking a bit about Salafism because with the wealth and the money and what the government of Saudi Arabia did, they are all over the world. And as I said, it's overpraising our own scholars or their own scholars and down the other people. For example, I'm just going to give an example here so you understand the problems we're faced with today. Al-Bukhari alayhi rahmatullah, the guy with Sahih al-Bukhari, a man born in the year 194, i.e. almost at the beginning of the 3rd century, so towards the end of the 2nd century. And he died in the year 256. He lived like 61 years, 9 months, let's say 62 years, okay? Whenever you hear them speak about Al-Bukhari, Saudi Arabia, all these places, you would think they are talking about someone who comes out from the extraordinary. For example, yeah, they will tell you he is brought up by his mother. This is, again, a way of softening your heart. This is an orphan, a kid that was brought up by his own mother, a mother who was not rich. She did everything she could to make sure that her kid was taken care of. You see how your heart is softening here? Now, let me tell you what comes after that. And then at the age of 16, but before that, at the age of 10, Al-Bukhari had already memorized Al-Quran and a few hadith, like 100, 200 hadith at the age of 10. But when he was a little kid, Al-Bukhari had lost his vision. He became blind. At that time there, once you lose your eyesight, you lose it. But our books of history, and when they speak about Al-Bukhari, they say that his mother spent countless nights crying to Allah, making dua, and they would go to tell you what kind of dua she made. And she would say, "Ya Allah, Allah, Allah." And then they tell you this heartwarming, his mother, the mother of Al-Bukhari, in one night saw in the dream the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam, who told her that Allah has returned your child's eyesight. Lo and behold, in the morning when she wakes up, Al-Bukhari became all observant, all seeing one more time, just like that, pure miracle. Now, in your mind, you start thinking, this mother has got a good relationship with Allah. The kid must be a prodigy kid to deserve or to be given that. Carry on. When he was at the age of 16, Al-Bukhari had already memorized 70,000 hadith. I want you to take a moment here. 16. 70,000 hadith. That is it's a mind-boggling. When I say 70,000 hadith, it's not only the text of the hadith, but the chain of narrators, because at that moment there, that was what it was. You cannot just memorize the hadith. You gotta memorize the hadith and the chain of narrators. Now, if you want to do some maths and just like some calculation, let's do that. 70,000 hadith. Until the age of 10, Al-Bukhari was just busy memorizing the Quran and a couple hadiths, okay? So we're gonna count from the age of 10 till 16. That's what he said. So we've got 6 years in hand. So if I divided 70,000 hadith by 6 years, I will end up with 11,667 hadith per year. That is 11,667 hadith per year. So every year, Al-Bukhari would memorize 11,667. So I take this digit here, this number, and divide it by 355, because that's the lunar year. So I divide 11,667 by 355, and I get that Al-Bukhari, every single day, non-stop, for the next 6 years, memorizes 33 hadith a day. And I'm talking about puberty, where kids play, where the world of puberty is completely different. But for us, Al-Bukhari memorizes 33 hadith every single day. Carry on. They say, to make you shut up your mouth and never ask any question, that Al-Bukhari had such an ability that he would pick up any book, and he would look at it once, and the whole entire book is completely memorized, committed to memory. None, that's it. So you can take, I don't know. Now, to me, that is a problem. If you tell me it took him years to memorize the Qur'an, why didn't he memorize the Qur'an in one go? Because if he could only read the book in one day, then normally the Qur'an, I'm going to give you like, okay, if you want to read the Qur'an, that's, we're going to give him 1 week. Every week he divides the Qur'an into 7 parts. All he has to do is read the Qur'an once and he memorized it. Why it took him 4 years? Not four, if F-O-U-R, but why did it take him years to memorize the Qur'an? As you can see, we can always find irregularities in those magnifying or magnificent stories that they tell us about him. But anyhow, when he got to 18, he started writing the hadith for his Sahih al-Bukhari. Not to entertain you for long, because I don't want this talk to go on forever, al-Bukhari collected all the hadith for Sahih al-Bukhari for 16 years. So he worked continuously 16 years to compile his book of authentic hadith. Out of 600,000 hadith, he only took a total of 2,602 hadith that he considers authentic. And because his book, he repeats the hadith, he truncates hadith, he cuts the hadith, he changes here and there. When you look in the entire book of Sahih al-Bukhari, you find about 7,397 hadith. But just the hadith themselves without the repetition is 2,602 hadith. Out from 600,000 hadith, his student Muslim, who is the teacher, and he studied with al-Bukhari about 16 years, so it's not a year or two. Muslim never ever mentioned a hadith about al-Bukhari from al-Bukhari, and Bukhari didn't mention hadith from Muslim. Abu Dawood, al-Tirmidhi, al-Nasa'i, Ibn Majah, the same thing, and Ahmed ibn Hanbal, and all these people, they lived in the same era. But these people also didn't take from al-Bukhari. They went ahead and looked for the hadith. So the question that I can ask is, all those 600,000 hadith that al-Bukhari did not classify as good enough to make it to his book, why the other scholars took them, and why have they become our religion for us? Wouldn't it have been enough what al-Bukhari has disregarded? We should also disregard. And the other thing is, what al-Bukhari chose because of his own choice, that became Islam. It's not Allah anymore who chooses what makes Islam and what makes not Islam. But again, they tell you this, and that's how it is. They make it, they make al-Bukhari seem, I can tell you tons of stories. For example, al-Bukhari, one day in his collection of hadith, he heard that some man has a hadith. So al-Bukhari goes to him, and when he meets the man, he sees the man from far calling a small sheep. But the man did not have something in his hand to lure the sheep to come to him. So he was just moving his fingers, like we do with our cat, like you do with a little kid. It's a benign gesture just to make the animal think you've got something, so that the animal comes and you catch the animal, or you make the baby come, and so on and so forth. When al-Bukhari saw that man, as the books say, al-Bukhari turned away, and they say he had walked, or he has ridden the animal for days to get that, to that day. Some books they say weeks. And just because he saw the man do that, he turned away, because that man was not honest. If the man is not honest with an animal, he can't be honest with the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But al-Bukhari then later on goes in his book and he plays with the hadith. Any name that is anti-Muawiyah, al-Bukhari changed it, or just puts Fulan, somebody. He mutilates the hadith so they don't attack Banu Umayyah. But to him, that's okay. In between the two, tricking an animal and playing with a hadith, I'd prefer to play to trick an animal as opposed to play with a hadith. Al-Bukhari in his book says that he has written the entire Bukhari, his Sahih, in Mecca. And the other books, they say he roved the land, and every time he wanted to write a hadith, Al-Bukhari would make a wudu and pray two rak'at istikhara, and then he would write the hadith to make sure it's authentic. And that, in your heart as a Muslim, you buy the whole story, your brain is totally washed, that this man must be a prophet that we didn't hear about it. Because of all this, and I can tell you, people have written books about the great man of Al-Bukhari. The most funny one that I heard, but it's in our books and the scholars of hadith still insist this is authentic, that Al-Bukhari one day went to Samarkand, somewhere now northern of Kazakhstan, all these countries. He walks in that city, he finds 400 scholars of hadith, all of them waiting to test him. Mr. Al-Bukhari gets there, subhanallah, I don't know how people can believe this kind of story, but here it is. Al-Bukhari then is approached by all these 400. What does this man do? They will report a hadith. The chain of narrators is different. Some of them would recite the chain of narrators. For example, yeah, one heard it from two from three from four, and then another scholar comes, he brings the same hadith, but he will make it that the hadith goes, the chain of narrators, that one reported from three, five from six, nine from two, seven from eight. So it no longer is from one, two, three in sequence. Another one would bring the same hadith, but he will play with words. We'll put one word forward, the other one backward. Another one, he would mix the cities. Someone from a city, from the other city, they mix the thing. I.e. the 400 scholars played. Imagine if each scholar brought one hadith and they played. So here we've got like 400 hadiths. But you're going to be generous and you're going to make it like 200, okay? And then Al-Bukhari was sitting there and listening to them as they did what they did. When they all finished, then Al-Bukhari spoke and he started. You, the scholar A, you said this. No, the hadith is not that. It's like this. And he mentioned the hadith, spotless, chain of narrator, correct. The man is absolutely, you number two, you number three, you number four, you number 99, you 299, you number 399, you scholar number 400, you say this. And Al-Bukhari had everything correct. He made everybody speechless. You know what? People that attack Islam today are making fun of us because of such stories. And we, the Salafis, we, the Wahhabis, we, the pro this and pro the, we are actually making fun of people when they tell us stories. And here we are with stories today. Same thing for when they speak about Ibn Taymiyyah. They make you feel Ibn Taymiyyah is Sheikh al-Islam, he is the authority, he knows everything, math, science, everything, so much so that they said, a hadith unknown by Ibn Taymiyyah is not a hadith. Ibn Taymiyyah is good in chemistry, in physics, in math, in geography, in geology, everything. He's great in Christianity, in Judaism, great in any philosophies, Greek philosophy. They tell you this man has never seen anyone by him. So when you read his life, I can't believe actually I made talks about his life back in time. But now I can see, subhanAllah, how when you have your mind in control and your brain is washed, it's unbelievable how you can see different things as if they were the absolute truth. So much so that today when Ibn Taymiyyah talks, it's like Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has spoken. We can't argue. Even though his books are full of takfir and full of wrong stuff, long of bloodshed, you know, and things. You see, Islam changed a few times. The very first one is when Al-Mutawakkil came in the 3rd century, and Islam never looked like it was before. Ahmed ibn Hanbal, that also. And that, because that is the birth of the Hanabila. It's a vile sect, and they represent Saudi Arabia. I'm not saying it because it's that, but because it's in the books. Enough to say that Al-Imam al-Tabari, who doesn't know al-Tabari? They call him Sheikh al-Mufassirin. He's the greatest Sheikh of all Mufassirin. This man was stoned to death in his own house. When he died, they could not bury him daytime because the Hanbali school of thought, i.e. what we have here in Saudi Arabia, those people who live in Saudi Arabia, would object to his burial. And so Al-Tabari was buried at night, and his tomb was hidden from the Hanbali because they promised if they know where he is buried, they would go and dig him out and crucify him dead. Why? Because he said few things that that Hanbali school of thought or the Salafi school of thought, the Wahhabi school, they're all the same. They are all the same. Do not agree with him. But anyway, so that is As I said, brainwashing you that the scholar is an absolute authority. They want you to believe Ahmed ibn Hanbal. They call him the Imam Sunnah. He's the Imam of the people of the Sunnah. He saved people. He saved the Qur'an. People said the Qur'an was created. And Ibn Hanbal said no. And he endured for 3 years. He was lashed thousands and blah, blah, blah. So that's it, Ahmed ibn Hanbal. You feel absolutely like a cockroach in front of these people. But they are not prophets. You see, at the end of the day, Allah didn't send them. He sent a man that is a mercy to mankind. Ahmed ibn Hanbal is not a mercy to mankind. Ibn Taymiyyah is not a mercy to mankind. Al-Bukhari is not a mercy to mankind. None of the humans since Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam until the end of time and before him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam were not. Each prophet was mercy to his own people except Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's the only one. This is why Allah says in the Quran, وَإِنْ تُطِيعُهُ تَهْتَدُوا. And if you obey Him, you will be guided. How do you obey Him, Allah? Well, we've got the Quran, primary source. And then the hadith, the practical hadith that works with the Quran, we take it upon our head, for example. Allah speaks to us about the wudu, He explains how we make the wudu. Then the sunnah comes and shows us how we make wudu. The practical act, work with the wudu, yeah, good deal. Well, I'll take that because that's what it is. But when they bring in a new law that Allah hasn't mentioned in the Quran, like this entering the toilet and you make the dua, and we make it as part of al-Islam when Allah has not mentioned it, then we have got a big problem. And now al-Islam is being attacked day and night. You see, I go on YouTube and I listen to different people. Now, I don't only listen to what these scholars, I listen to a variety of different people. Because to me, it's of great interest to see what people who attack Islam, what they say. The other day, I was listening to this Muslim, as I said, Salafi person that left Islam and he became a Christian, and now he's got like his teeth out like the walrus or like a canine of a lion or a dog, and he is really going into Islam and speaking. The other day I was listening to him and he said, لِمَذَا كَفَرْتُ بِالْقُرْآنِ? Why I became a disbeliever of Al-Qur'an? And I was listening and alhamdulillah, I don't have a problem with these things. Al-Qur'an is deep in my core. Nothing's gonna shape or change that. So I was listening to that and he was saying things. But what he said to me, it kept a grin on my face because I can answer him. But I didn't say things. But what really amazed me is the people, their nationalities from around the world. These people were Muslims before, and now they followed his documentary or his series, and they abandoned Islam. These people, they come from Saudi Arabia. Atheism and Christianity are great number in Saudi Arabia. It's just the government doesn't want you to know. From all different parts of the world. For small idiocies, you know why Al-Quran is being attacked? Not because of Al-Quran, but because of what the scholars today, and they bring videos, it's always the Salafis at the forefront. Always, always, always. And they talk about them. But anyway, more on this later on. Once they have made you feel small in front of the scholar, now is the time to make you feel small in front of his book. Again, Al-Bukhari. Al-Bukhari, every time they speak, they tell you Al-Bukhari, the book of Al-Bukhari, is the most authentic book after the book of Allah. La ilaha illallah. I personally hate this expression from my core. And I looked for hours, who uttered, who said this term, who said this sentence, who was the first one to have said it. We don't know who said it. But however, Al-Zahabi, Al-Imam Al-Nawawi, and few other scholars, Al-Farabari, and few other scholars, they kept saying this. Ibn Taymiyyah said this, Al-Albani said this, Al-Huwaini said that. Every Wahhabi scholar or Salafi scholar or Hanbali scholar would say this. And I reject this categorically. Of course, to them I am kafir, I am whatever it is. But the reason being is, Al-Bukhari came in the 3rd century. People have lived before him 300 years without his hadith, without his authentication, without. So you're telling me that the Sahaba didn't have any hadith and And even in the text we got, they say we must follow the Qur'an as Abu Bakr, Umar, and all these companions. And only 300 years later, some Bukhari come, writes hadith, and it becomes a religion for us. But anyway, they say that the Bukhari's book is the most authentic hadith, authentic book after the book of Allah. You know what else they say? And I had few brothers, they are going to listen to my talk one night, and we brought one of the Salafi Wahhabi scholars and Shuyukha, a very prominent figure. And he said that Al-Imam Al-Qurtubi, and this is sad news that Al-Qurtubi wrote this in his book, that the hadith of Rasulullah SAW can nullify and negate an ayah from the Qur'an. Na'udhu billah. And they've got no shame in saying this, i.e. a hadith reported in Al-Bukhari. If it contradicts an ayah in the Qur'an, guess who wins? The hadith. So why do we have a Qur'an? Why do we say the book of Allah is untouchable? Why does Allah say that al-kitab, this Qur'an here, and it's a kitab mubarak, la ya'tihi al-batin bayni yadihi wa la khalfihi, that this book is the most blessed book, that no wrongness and no falsehood shall come to him either from the front or the back? Why is the Qur'an a goodness to mankind? Why do we need this Qur'an? If the hadith can negate, when people stone, they say we stone a fornicator to death. Al-Quran says lash them 100 times. We don't even have the hadith that says al-Jumu'ah. When you ask them, they say, well, at the time of Rasulullah, there was a hadith. What is this hadith? They go, oh, Rasulullah did it. Oh, come on. For 300 years? But anyhow, the problem with this is overpraising the books. Ibn Taymiyyah's books are this. That's why when they mention Ibn Taymiyyah says in, and you go, okay. Ibn says in, Al-Bukhari says in, that hadith says in, and these books become more prominent, more valuable to Muslims than the Quran itself. And believe me, when the French invaded Egypt, when problems happened in North Africa, invasion and all that kind of stuff, you know what the Muslims did? They would recite Al-Bukhari in the masjid, hoping that Allah would help them. Not Al-Quran, Al-Bukhari. Until our days, in Libya, Tunisia, Algeria, Morocco, Mauritania, and Egypt, and few other places, they will always swear by Al-Jah of the Prophet i.e. what Rasulullah can do for you, intercession, things like that, and by Al-Bukhari. They still swear by Al-Bukhari. Can you imagine that? Still happens until our days. It's in our movies and things like that. Allah Kareem, Allah Kareem. Number 6, they also mind control you and brainwash you by the claim that Al-Islam is being attacked day in and day out. And this is to gain unanimity, i.e. we all become unanimous, all we become the same body. And any questions that, for example, if they hear my talk here, if you give it to a Salafi, and I've been attacked and I am attacked in England, and believe it or not, what they say about me, sometimes they go, really? You know, I never thought of myself like that. But anyhow, these people, whenever like this, I'm teaching you to start thinking for yourself. Don't let anyone brain control you or mind control you, brainwash you into thinking that you got to think like what Ibn Taymiyyah says. You don't need to. The only way you need to think is what Allah says in the Quran. If you don't have the ability to read Arabic and understand, because Allah talks to what? He doesn't talk to scholars to translate to us. Allah talks to us. You know, Allah talks to you. So if you can't do that, if you can't read Arabic, then don't read one translation of the meanings only. Have 4 or 5, and you've got, you are on the internet today. Go on that. And one book you should never ever reference alone is the Sahih International, financed, supported, and pushed by the Wahhabi and the Hanbali school of thought, or the Salafi, to push their agenda. Allah doesn't say many things that are in that book, but again, they say them so that you take that with them. Technique number 7, An-Nasikh wal-Mansukh, the abrogated and abrogator text. What this means is, Wallahi al-Azim, Al-Quran, even though they tell you the book of Allah, what the Salafi people should say is this. We should follow those parts of the book of Allah that has not been abrogated. Because to them, the book of Allah is not complete. parts of it are no longer relevant. As such, any part in Al-Quran that talks about mercy and love and choice and freedom, to them they don't exist. You don't have a reason to have them. For example, any ayah to them in Al-Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives the freedom to someone to believe or not to believe or do what they do, whatever they want to do, because Allah on Judgment Day is going to hold them accountable, all those ayah that are above 500 in Al-Quran are no longer relevant, because they say there is an authentic hadith in Bukhari and Muslim. Again, Bukhari, you know, it's the third Quran or the second Quran that you get, that the hadith says that any person that fulfills or that does one of the three must be killed. One of them, so whoever changes his religion, kill him. Whoever leaves the group, kills them. So here to them here, whoever changes his religion, if you choose, you know what, I don't want to believe, I want to do something else, then you must be killed. Allah doesn't say that at all in the Quran. In my discussions with people, and that's why now, well, if someone wants, especially the Salafi, if they want to debate something with me, unless they are knowledgeable and they are not of these people, they're going to tell me the Quran is abrogated. Because every time I mention an ayah, oh, that ayah is abrogated. Every time you bring in, oh, that ayah is no longer valid. So one day I told somebody, when you say it's not valid, when I read it, do I get the reward of it or not? He goes, of course you get the reward of it. I go, okay, and on Judgment Day, will Allah ask me about it? You know, he starts looking at me, because what I want him to really get is absolutely tell me that ayah is actually only there for its writing only, and believe it or not, this exists in our books. Our great books of scholars, Al-Qurtubi, Al-Tawari, and few other people, they will tell you this ayah has been abrogated. And why is it in Al-Quran? This is just to tell you that it's been there at one point. Of course, this is a lie. And I have once compiled a hadith, the research about the abrogated, and it never was the case at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam or the companions. So this is tactic or technique number 7, is they make you believe that the text you're reading, every time you say this, they say it's abrogated. Anyone who tells you something in the Quran is abrogated is a liar. Don't listen to them, even if their beard is actually to their toes. Don't believe them. Number 8, emphasize the school of thought terminologies, and this is to discourage you to debate with them. For example, they would say, a salaf, a salah, the righteous predecessors did this. And you go, wow, well, the Sahaba did that? They go, yes. But what they don't tell you is, we actually are liars, we're just giving you our side of the coins. Other scholars of the school of thought, as I said, the five groups that I mentioned in my Decree on Predestination, and many other scholars don't see the same thing as we do. In Mecca or in Saudi Arabia, the Wahhabis, the Salafis, they see it in one way. In Egypt, they actually don't see it at all. But the way the Wahhabis speak to you or the Salafis speak to you is they make you believe like they actually are the private secretaries of the righteous predecessors, that they were there, they filmed everything. So they will tell you, a Salaf, a Salaf, the righteous predecessors say, anyone who keeps nagging and hammering righteous predecessors, just ignore them. They say the scholars of the Ummah said, the scholars of the Ummah, as Ahmed ibn Hanbal said, whoever tells you that the scholars have all met or all gathered or agreed unanimously on one issue is a liar. There is no agreement between scholars whatsoever. So anyone tells you the scholars of the Ummah said is liar. All the questions that need to ask were asked before. So if you ask, who are you? Why do you ask that question? It's already been asked before. You don't need, and only those questions that were asked before and answered have a right to exist. Any new questions do not need to. That's a control, mind control, vile technique. Again, unanimously agreed between scholars, ignore that. They also emotionalize the talk, tears, soft voices, total submission to Allah. You know, the Sahaba, Allah, I tell you, the Sahaba, they used to do that. And you feel like in your heart, ya Allah, this person actually is receiving revelation right now. But actually, they are doing that to manipulate your emotions. Either they like it or they dislike it. They're doing it purposefully or not, but that's what it is. Also, when describing women, the terminologies they use, they don't say the Muslim woman, they would go, the chaste, pure, clean, honorable, God-fearing Muslim that covers herself. That's it. They, you know, in fashion, they Photoshop the models, you know, in the front cover. They Photoshop them so they look the best. Our Salafi Wahhabi scholars, when they speak about women, they verbally Photoshop the woman. She's the chaste, pure, clean, honorable, God-fearing person. So, i.e., if you are not just like that person, you ain't gonna be no chaste, no pure, no clean, no honorable, and no God-fearing person at all. This is why you still keep miserable, you still keep like you're committing a sin, no matter what you do. It's because the way they talk to us. Again, for the brother, again, they say the same thing. The brother has a beard and he does this and he wears that. Beard is not part of Islam. Believe it or not, there is no agreement between the scholars. When they say the four school of thoughts agreed on the beard, what they mean is there are four school of thoughts, a Hanafi, a Maliki, a Shafi, and a Hanbali. One scholar from each school of thought, let's say four of them, yeah? And then they say, let's say the four school of thoughts agree. When in fact, not at all. Many scholars have disagreed that the beard is nothing else but what Quraysh had, what the Jews had at that time, what the Christian had at that time. And so they made it into, you got to have a beard, you got to look, and you got to do that to be pious. Haven't you noticed, my brothers and my sisters, that people that are very Wahhabi and very Salafi, when they come on television or to you, they always dress up like the Saudi people, thinking to them that that is how the Sahaba were. In fact, that is got nothing to do. What the Saudis wear on top of their head is nothing but political symbols. Again, on my 19 things that I made, the 19 things that were haram and were halal today, I explain about the shmach and the lagal and all these things that the Saudis wear. So as you can see, even now, the Christians in the world, the Orientalists in the world, what they have started is when they started attacking Islam, they started dressing up like the Saudis. So that your mind, when you see these kind of things, you would think that actually this is closer to the Sunnah. When in fact, the dress has absolutely nothing to do with Islam, especially for men. And also the beard and all that kind of stuff has nothing to do with Al-Islam. Number 9, manipulate historical events and only use what serves them, their agendas. I'll give an example. Every Muslim knows how Tariq ibn Ziyad conquered Spain. And we tell very beautiful stories, our small handful of people, and how he had some canoes and some little boats. And when he stood by the sea, the Mediterranean, and told his armies, the enemy is behind you, the sea is in front of you, so it's either you fight or either you do that. And then what they say is these great people, they fought and they won the battle, and that's how the word of Allah got spread in Egypt and blah, 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 blah. All right, I say blah, 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 because everything that you hear is nothing but mind control to make us people always wanting to die. Haven't you noticed, like, the life of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, in Mecca he was abused, in Medina he retaliated? That's all there is to it. So to us Muslims, we always speak, if we were men, if our women were well-dressed, we would have beaten up the Jews. Guess what? This is the biggest lie. Because if we take piety to piety, let's say we are closer to Allah than them. Their women are less dressed than our women, but why are they kicking our butt every round the corner? Because Allah put certain rules on earth. You use them, you win. You don't use them, you don't win. But let me go back now to Tariq ibn Ziyad. Tariq ibn Ziyad, this man who did what he did and the way he is, that's what they tell you. But let me tell you the dark side of the story is that the great general Tariq ibn Ziyad was arrested by Musa ibn Nusayr, an Arab man who was working for Banu Umayyah. Reason being is because when Tariq ibn Ziyad conquered Spain, they would send money, young, beautiful, virgin women, about 200,000 were sent to Damascus. And of course, you would know a young, beautiful girl taking Spain and beautiful eyes and the Berbers and all that kind of stuff, you would take them to Syria. What do you think is going to happen? But anyhow, later on, that number came down, the money came down, so Abdul Malik ibn Marwan sends Musa ibn Nusayr to arrest Tariq ibn Ziyad. Tariq ibn Ziyad was arrested and sent and mistreated, beaten up, then sent to Damascus, and there he died. Less than a year later, Musa ibn Nusayr, the man who arrested Tariq ibn Ziyad, also was accused of the same thing, betrayal, stealing money, and taking women. And guess what? The same fate that he endured, Tariq ibn Ziyad, happened to him. But you never hear this. Why? Because our Salafi people, our Salaf, they went to Spain, but they don't tell you how they died. They died as traitors, thieves. That's how they died. So again, the usage of history, and I can tell you stories upon stories, but the hour is coming up, so I need to go fast. And the last point is the negative stereotyping of outsiders, and that is the looks. They make you all dress up in the same way and behave in the same way, and anyone who doesn't behave or dress up like you is a negative outsider, is someone who is not part of you. And this is how we create a Muslim community within a Muslim community, within, and we don't have one unified Muslim community at all. Why? Because they make you believe and brainwash you into thinking and control your mind into thinking that you are the only one who does what you do, because you're not the only person. You've got the other people that look like you, and because strength is in numbers, so because you're doing that, you are upon the truth, and the other people that are not doing what you are doing, they are not upon the truth. I can go on and give you a few other things, but usually all the mind control techniques happen within these 10 points that I mentioned. So please be careful. Anything that you hear, question. There is always a second side to the equation. Look for it. If people brainwash you, women should obey their husband, should. It's a lie. Always, especially when it comes from Salafism, always take it with a pin of a very pin of the hardest salt you can ever put your hand on. These people are not honest. They are always working under agenda, and they just disguise their agenda by it's the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What's in Al-Quran is the sunnah of Rasulullah, especially when it comes to the interaction between people, between Muslim to Muslim, Muslim to non-Muslim, and things selling. Wallahi, everything is in Al-Quran, and I can give a whole talk about why Al-Quran is the book, and I promise I will do that one other day. I pray to Allah to open our hearts and our eyes to all these and save us from this mind manipulation and brainwashing. A lot of Muslims these days are living Islam. They are leaving Islam, not living Islam, but they are leaving Islam and quitting it because for years they have been brainwashed into thinking something. And now that the internet has brought up a different variety of people, the YouTube, and the attacks have started on Islam, those people that have been mind controlled and brainwashed, what happened to them is a complete, total shock. And one of the shocks will be delivered tomorrow, and that is about Al-Aqsa in Jerusalem. Do the Jews really have a say in it or not? Is what happens today in Palestine, is it really religious, or does it have politics? Tomorrow you will listen and you will know what I mean by the mind control and the brainwash. I pray to Allah to help us all. Wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad. Ya Allah, help us all stay away from the mind control and brainwash of these people, and help us stay closer to your book until we meet you and you are pleased with us. Again, this is your brother Abdusalam Abu Hanifa. If you want to join my group, please do send me a message on 0787640 8735. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.